In this video, we'll break down the concept of natural monopoly. We'll look at why they exist and discuss some examples. After we have established their characteristics, we'll analyze the diagram and consider how they may be regulated. If you have questions at any point in this video, leave them in the comments and I'll try to respond. To understand the concept of natural monopoly, let's take the case of a city planning on building a new subway system. After the plans have been made, the project begins. It requires the purchase of subway cars, the digging of subway tunnels, laying down tracks, and establishing a safe subway network. The startup costs of such a project are very high. That brings us to our first characteristic, high fixed costs. Think about the city of Beijing with a population of over 20 million people. A subway system that could serve that many people would be very costly to design, build, and maintain. The high startup costs would also act as a deterrent to the entry of new firms. Consider the financial capital they would need to have to start such a project. In China specifically, this kind of project is only undertaken by the government. The high fixed costs that the single firm faces are averaged out over a larger quantity of production. That is our second characteristic, the potential for economies of scale at very high levels of output. The firm is able to achieve the lowest average cost by serving the entire market. There is a greater benefit to society of having one firm as it can achieve such low average costs and provide the consumer with a lower price than if the market were competitive. But let's suppose for a moment that another firm does enter the market. Why would the introduction of competition result in higher prices for consumers? To see why this is the case, let's look at the long run average cost for such a firm. If it produces quantity Q star of output, which corresponds to the very high level of output we discussed earlier, then their average costs of production are C star. Assume output is cut in half as two firms are present in the market. This results in higher average costs of C1 as each firm produces an output of Q1. Therefore, the economies of scale are best exploited by the presence of one firm only. The presence of additional firms would result in a wasteful duplication of resources and higher prices for consumers. Ultimately, this means that competition actually reduces the welfare of consumers and that the market is more efficient with the existence of one firm. We'll see why as we work our way through the diagram next. The long-run average cost curve continues to slope downwards at increasingly higher levels of output. Thus, marginal costs are also decreasing as a firm increases the size of its production. The demand curve intersects the long-run average cost curve while it is downward sloping, and marginal revenue is derived from the original demand curve. This is our basis for starting our analysis. Next, we need to determine how a profit-maximizing firm would behave in this situation. They would maximize profits where marginal revenue equals marginal cost. So let's find that point. If this firm produces at its profit-maximizing level of output, it will charge P star for quantity Q star. Its cost per unit is C star. In this case, the firm is earning supernormal profit as shown in green. In the case of natural monopolies, the government is likely to intervene or regulate in the interest of consumers. In our subway example, there is a market failure as social welfare is not maximized and a small number of people are taking the subway relative to the allocatively efficient level of output. Society would be best served by price PS, which would result in a quantity QS being consumed. However, at this price, the firm's cost per unit are CS, resulting in subnormal profit or an economic loss. Traditional theory suggests that the firm should leave the market at this point. This would be worse than charging a higher price. So what's the solution? The government could offer this firm a subsidy of XY per unit to help it cover its loss. The reason they may be willing to do that is due to the higher social benefits of greater consumption of this good. With more people on the subway, there are less people driving. There are many other benefits of a subway system that are not included in simple cost and revenue calculations. Therefore, the cost of the subsidy, XY times QS, results in an outcome in which societal welfare is improved overall. Allocative efficiency is achieved because price is equal to marginal cost. Productive efficiency is achieved because a firm is producing at its lowest average cost of production. The most common examples of natural monopolies are given are public utilities companies that provide gas, water, and electricity. These are generally necessities for consumers, so the government would want a situation in which the largest amount of people have access to them at lower prices than if these firms operated strictly for profit. social welfare is improved as a result of this regulation or intervention, or at least the aim is to achieve that. While I gave the example of subsidies in my analysis, there are many other methods of regulating natural monopolies, including price capping and nationalization. We'll look at these further in future videos. You should now have a better understanding of natural monopolies, why they exist, and how to analyze the diagram as well. If you have any questions, leave them below or email me at enhancedtuition@gmail.com.